All right, welcome back to Pucks in Deep. We got episode 65 here. I'm your co-host, Connor Thelman, with me as always.
Your co-host, James Murray. Fans, we got a big one for you this weekend.
Big
it's
one.
The national champions
big.
Out of UMass/NewMass.
NewMass.
We got Captain Jake Gaudet as well as Associate Head Coach Jared DeMichiel.
DeMike. We got two dads on.
Yeah. I mean,
just
absolutely.
Absolute leaders and wagons. You want to listen to both interviews. And we're back from Pittsburgh. We made it. We'll have a recap for you guys afterwards, but just stay tuned. You're going to love everything they got to say. Welcome back to Pucks in Deep here, episode number 65, James.
Yep, it's a big one. We're all hungover here, but we're here regardless.
Oh, assumptions being thrown. I think Jake looks better than all of us somehow, which is crazy. But yeah, I guess I should jump into it. Our guest today, we got two natty champs. The first off is El Capitano, number 18. I think mayor of Pittsburgh and Amherst currently. Jake Gaudet. How we feeling, Jake?
Good. Still surviving. Still pretty excited.
I can tell with the t-shirt choice. I mean, obviously, it's been a big week for you guys. Like, right now, I think you're kind of having a break in the celebrations, but like how crazy has that been around campus? I mean, like, we've seen the ZoomAss post where it just looks buzzing like something's about to burn down, but like how sick has that been seeing all the people going nuts there?
Yeah, it's crazy. It's especially this year, like not having any fans at the games, to go from like pretty much no fans to all of a sudden like having thousands of people out. When we got home on Sunday, it was pretty special, like especially driving into Amherst. There's cars that we had a police escort, I think. So there's cars basically pulled over on the other side. People are, you know, honking and waving. So it was pretty cool, especially for a lot of us to see it. Yeah, it meant a ton to all of us.
How many fans were there waiting for you when the bus rolled through?
There was a lot. I don't know, like, number count, but just if you see those videos, it was crazy.
Was that the best feeling in the world, getting out that bus, turning your shoulder, and boom, lifting that trophy, and there's fans everywhere?
They're all lined up. We popped the windows off the side of the bus. We're like, you know, high-fiving everybody. It was crazy. Yeah, one of the coolest things I've been a part of.
How long did it take for you? Because I saw when you got off that bus, you still had the net going as like a little bit of a...
still like, rocking.
Yeah, a little like cornrow or something. How long were you rocking the net look?
That was about probably the end of the Nets days. Yeah, it's in safekeeping now, but it had a pretty good run.
Yeah, that was some style.
He's still wearing it right now.
Yeah, first game in the pros, just skate out with it and just draped off the back. That'd be a power move.
Yeah, I made it into underwear. Yeah, so I just wore it full time.
God, I love it. But I mean, like, just thinking back to the Frozen Four, like, I mean, we're going to put together a clip here, so I don't know if that was a great transition. But when I was just watching you guys, like, before games, like, we had... like the snap story, you guys were all around the corner and you dapped up Bobby, and I was like, God, they're gonna take it right here. Like,
yeah,
I placed
over.
A bet after that happened. It was the dap heard around the world. Like, how confident were you guys coming into every game? Because it looked like, you know, you're just like loose out there.
Yeah, I think we benefited from being there 2 years ago. So like getting back to kind of this stage, there's definitely a lot of almost calm confidence. I thought, guys, there's no surprises. Like, we'd been there before, we kind of knew what the process was like. And I think for all the guys that had been there before, the upperclassmen, there was just some comfort, I think, in knowing kind of what to expect, and it allowed us to prepare maybe with some more confidence. Yeah. And we tried to stay loose just to make sure that, you know, the younger kids that weren't there were kind of leading by example for them.
Yeah, that's smart. And then like to come into it versus UMD being a few guys down, like your goalie and Carson there, like, was that extra motivation almost just like, well, I mean, we're missing two of our big guys. They've helped us get here. We need to go to the ship just to give them another chance to play.
Yeah, for sure. And I think going through that the week before, you know, we were riding so high after Bridgeport to get that positive result. Like, I think, I want to say it was Friday. We got a text where it was like team Zoom at 9:45. It was like 9:15. You're like, man, this can only be one thing. And it's just terrible. We're all just like, oh no. And sure enough, you know, we had a COVID case. So for 2 days, it didn't look like we were going to get to go to Pittsburgh. I think for all of us, we knew if we were going to get to go, we were going to do everything we could to get Carson and Fila and Jerry and Henry another game.
Just all the boys. So like, yeah, no one knew, like, you're like, well, who is it? Because I bet you're all feeling good too. You're like, shit, it could be anybody at this point. That is nuts. Oh man.
Yeah.
What about, I did want to ask, so I'm a UMD guy. But I mean, obviously I was a UMass guy after that game. So that one hurt me a little bit. But like just seeing you guys come out for overtime, literally flying around them after three just hard-ass periods. Like, how many smelling salts did you do before you came out on the ice? Because you guys were literally just tearing it up.
Yeah, all of them. Yeah, oh. All the smelling salts. No, we, I think we struggled a bit at the start of that game. We didn't get to practice a ton going in, so it almost felt like guys were just tired. Like, it was really heavy legs, and we almost shook that in the third period. And I think we felt pretty fresh, honestly, going into overtime. And I think getting to that stage, especially scoring that goal to push it to overtime, it almost felt like we figured out what we needed to do to be successful, and we kind of doubled down on that in overtime.
Yeah. I mean, what did DeMike personally say to you guys in the locker room, though? It had to have been
the
something.
The rah-rah speech.
Yeah. I mean, he got a... Sure. Yeah, what did he say in the locker room, if not Carter?
Yeah, DeMike. Yeah, DeMike came in. Yeah, I mean, all the coaches came in. Carvey was pretty frustrated with us after the second period, because we weren't playing very well. And to get to that stage and kind of lay an egg in the first two periods, we were pretty disappointed. But we obviously still had 20 minutes to basically play for our lives and for the opportunity to go to the championship again. And that doesn't motivate you, that I don't know what does.
Right. No, that was... Yeah. All in all, just a great game. I mean, that was back and forth. It was low scoring, but...
We were joking that that was the championship game, because, I mean, you guys came out, like, right from the get-go and took care... I mean, you must have found your legs in the first period, like, the first... After that shorty versus St. Cloud. Yeah. Because I kind of thought that one was over after it was 2-0. I mean, you guys are a very defensively sound team, but, like, how long did it take for that feeling to sink in with you? Like, you know, we got this in the bag, or did you not even think that, like, till, you know, the final whistle?
Trying to block out those thoughts, I think, until at least late in the third for the most part. Because, I mean, right. I think there was a game, I can't remember which one it was. I know it was Miami and BU a while back, where it was like one team, I remember, blew a lead like 3-0 in the third, something like that. Oh. So, I don't know. St. Cloud's a good team. They're pretty explosive offensively. So, for a lot of us, especially kind of wearing a letter, you're trying to make sure guys are still focused and still dialed in. And we had a meeting with Carvey, I think, the last media timeouts. There's like 3.5 minutes left, where he's kind of like, you guys are national champions, like, soak this in before it gets crazy. And we're all looking around, it's like, man, like, I can't even believe we're here. It doesn't feel real.
God, I want to hear that speech. even Carv's giving it up. I feel like he'd be the guy, I'd be like, you know, keep fucking skating, get it deep.
Yeah,
what are you guys doing here?
I mean, yeah, they said that, but then, you know, they're still gonna yell from the bench if guys are making mistakes right with a minute left. But that's how he's built.
How was the atmosphere this weekend in Pittsburgh with 25% capacity? I know we were there, so we definitely turned it up a little bit, but the rest of the crowd, what was the atmosphere like to play in front of for the Frozen Four?
You guys were leading from the front for sure. No, it was cool. We haven't had any fans right until the tournament, so it was pretty special. My sister and her boyfriend came out to Bridgeport, and then my whole fam was there this weekend, which was awesome. I haven't seen them really since August, so it was pretty special to have them there. Even just to have people in the building was pretty exciting.
Yeah, we ran into Papa Gaudet in the J. We're like, well, that's got to be him.
That's got. He's wearing his jersey. It was him.
There's no one else. He was fired the game.
Was loud, man. The concourse there, right when you walked in the gates of Pittsburgh. I mean, after the game, it was just packed with UMass fans just screaming.
You can feel it. And Bridgeport didn't have any, right? It was just friends and family for the most
part. Yeah, I think so. It was like we had 2 tickets each. I think that was pretty much it.
Shit, that is limited. Okay. Yeah. And then you got all the ECH boys. I mean, there's a lot of UMass fans there. Like, I'd say St. Cloud had more, but obviously they're quiet.
Yeah.
For the last one. Coming in, they're loud.
That brings up my question. Have you seen or heard of the UMass Reindeers? Is he still alive?
Yeah, we're worried.
That
we
guy.
Haven't heard anything.
No. No, I haven't.
That's not good.
Shit. Yeah. I wonder, he's still wearing the reindeer. I mean, like, you're still in the shirt. I don't think he's changed.
He hasn't showered. Yeah, he's just
he's only got one outfit.
He's just ripping it. I mean, he was tweeting the next day, so I guess he made it past the game.
Yeah, he made it one day.
Yeah, I haven't seen him since. So. That's tough. What about, I mean, just like how fired up Carves was. Like, I just seeing him do his victory lap. Like, at first he did like the mean mug, just holding it up, and then he started like doing the laps, and he had like the cheesiest smile, like ear to ear. I was like, man, that's the happiest guy I've ever seen. But like, how crazy was it to see him just, you know, like smile like that? Like, oh my god.
Yeah, it was cool. Like, for someone who's, you know, pretty calm, cool, collected all the time.
Yeah.
Right. For him to, you know, like, he was in tears at some point. He's worked extremely hard to kind of have that moment. He's put a ton. Like, our coaching staff works extremely hard. It's impressive. So for them to kind of get to that stage, you know, when they came in, the team was not very good, and I'm sure a lot of people have talked about that, but to have a 5-win season and to be able to turn that around, it takes a lot of hard work, and, you know, it's pretty special for all of them to have that moment.
I think we were talking about that a little bit the first time we had you on, but like, just a reminder for the people, like, were you ever thinking another school when you were getting recruited, or was there, you know, like, what led you to choose UMass and this coaching staff?
Yeah, I when I met with Coach Carvel, he kind of had a plan to turn the program around, and it was exciting to me to kind of get in on the ground floor and really cool school that plays in Hockey East and solid academically. And from the CCHL, you know, it's not very often you get an opportunity in Hockey East. So it came down to a few schools, but I actually broke my ankle my 20-year-old year junior. So some of those options disappeared. And luckily, UMass was still looking for a bigger size center. And yeah, obviously worked out.
Just for a captain. There's one thing that, you know, I didn't want to bring up, but we were talking about, you know, 20 blocks, 30 blocks before the season. I don't know if the stat sheet guy missed. We have yet 9 blocks. Like, was that?
Yeah.
What happened there? I mean, obviously it worked, so I'm not even like, mad about it.
It's harder as a center than it is. Block a ton of pucks, but okay. I also have beef with our stats guy. I don't think they count them quite accurately.
Yeah, there's no way.
I think I'd be around maybe the over under. I think was set at 21, I believe. I think it'd be around there. I don't know if it'd be over or not, but there's definitely more than 9.
Okay. Yeah. We officially have beef now too. I mean, you win a national championship, you got the C. I assume there's more and it just wasn't there. We also don't know. They didn't put down for St. Cloud game, so you probably had like 5 eats in the ship.
Okay.
Like easily. Yeah. So
easily.
Yeah, we got a little beef there, but all right. I just want to get it out. Again, that's the hard part of the interview. I don't like doing that.
What about Jonesy signing with the Rangers? What's your thoughts on that?
Ooh, yeah, get on that.
Pretty cool.
Pretty cool.
I mean, he's an unbelievable D-man. Like, he's so shifty out there. He's just a kid that, like, I don't know, for whatever reason, he's so skilled. And it's just, he has that kind of like innate gift on the blue line to just dance people out of their skates. And I don't know. I'm super excited for him. I think it's a wicked opportunity. And I think he'll hit the ground running there. Hopefully he does pretty well.
What about your future here? What's your plans for next year? You don't have to break anything, but, can I recommend Minnesota state of hockey? You know?
Yeah. I can't really say anything yet.
Yeah. That's right.
I'll be playing hockey next year. It's just a matter of where.
Okay. And not college. Is that, we're not going to break that? All right. We can cut
not,
it. We can
not
cut
college
it.
Hockey. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, you conquered it.
You conquered. That's a good way to go out, man.
On to the next.
I just want to say how many like fans or students that, you know, aren't on the hockey team have you talked to since the championship? Have you connected with a lot of people on the grounds of UMass there?
Yeah, a lot. I mean, we've been, wearing our gear a lot and going around town and stuff, right?
You
so
got it.
A ton of people. It's actually been pretty special. I think it meant a lot to a lot of UMass fans, and people are really, really excited to kind of get to share it and to cheer us on. And, you know, we go out to eat and people are kind of congratulating us. So it's pretty special. And, you know, there was people crying in their cars as we were busted by when we were driving into campus. And just to kind of see that on, you know, the other side of the TV, I guess, a little bit, was pretty special.
Yeah, wow. Hit them in the feels. Like, how big was that difference? Like, when you guys were leaving on the bus from Amherst, like before everything, because I mean, it had to be more like a ghost town. It's COVID, you know, everybody's doing Zoom class and you get back and it's like, it is UMass.
It is just like a zoo.
Was that on just the night and day? Like, yeah, we have students here.
Like, yeah, holy hell. No, crazy. And yeah, like it's hard to even wrap your head around. Like, it just felt like we were almost like back 2 years ago to kind of like a normal, normal life in some sense with all the people there. It was pretty cool.
Yeah, we should have went. I mean, that's, I don't think we would have made it out, but we should have tried.
We should have tried. That'd have been tough. That'd
not have legally been able to drive, you know?
No.
That would have been a long Uber.
What does your former teammate Kale McCarr have to say since the championship?
Yeah, he was excited. We FaceTimed him in the locker room after the game. He was pretty fired up. But
hell yeah.
Yeah, so I think he's pretty happy for us. And I think I wish we won one with him when he was here, but he's doing pretty well himself. So
he is. No, he's doing just fine. But that's a pretty cool story right there.
Yeah, Kale. I mean, like, or have you guys reached out to Leno or Ferraro or, you know, Chafee? All like, boys, everybody been calling in, just fired up. Like, I wish they would show up to the parade. Obviously, it's COVID, but like, you imagine how many sweaters
playing in the show. But
I mean, there's so many guys from that first team, you know.
Short walk from San Jose, Mario and Leno. Yeah, no, we've talked to a bunch of them. Everyone's pretty excited. Just that, you know, we were able to kind of get back to that stage. Even just to beat Duluth was super exciting, but to win the trophy was awesome. Everyone that's played at UMass is super excited. We've heard from a bunch of them, which has been awesome to kind of share that.
Is there a postseason party planned yet for all the UMass guys to play in the past 10 years? There should be. Just everyone gets together.
Ooh, that'd be sick.
That's actually a pretty good idea. Yeah, we've been joking about getting a reunion tour back for kind of our senior class. And Yeah, we'll have to come up with something. There's even talk about tattoos, but got much traction yet.
I like that. Just like a banner, or what would the tattoo be?
And where would it be?
I don't know.
Yeah, definitely don't know. An ass tat.
I'm not much of a graphic designer myself, so we're going to have to outsource that.
We'll make some mock-ups for you. We're talking ass tats. Like pencil diagrams. Yeah. I'll send you a few sketches. Yeah. What about
DeMike? Just lean the way. He's the first one to get it for sure.
Oh, he'd have to. he'd get two, you know?
Yeah.
What about number 18? Is that going up in the rafters? Like, I don't want anyone to wear it at UMass again. Can we get that started?
I don't know. I don't think so. But, I've been wearing the jersey a lot recently. It's pretty cool. I think to wrap up the career and all the work and 4 years here, kind of going through a lot of ups and downs. It's just talking with our seniors, it's a pretty special feeling to know the last time you'll wear it on the ice is, you know, we're holding the trophy and kind of making history for our school.
There was one that our boy Johnny, he couldn't make it because he's a big league now. He's doing some New York podcast, but he was mentioning how in one of your first team meetings, Coach Carville and Ben Barr took you guys and showed you film of UMass Lowell, said like, this is the example of how he wanted the team identity to be. He's saying, like, how fitting was it that you guys beat them? I mean, 1-0 shutout in the Hockey East final. And then, you know, then you beat the team that beat you 2 years prior in UMD. Like, how cool was that? Just kind of come full circle like that.
Yeah. Carvey's had a plan for UMass for a long time. And you look at Lowell, and Lowell's been successful with the brand of hockey that they've kind of created there. And I think it's with guys that, you know, maybe aren't five-star recruits, but they play really well within a defensive system and they compete extremely hard and they're hard to play against. I think that kind of model for a style of play plays well against BC and BU, a lot of the successful hockey schools. So for Carvey for a long time, yeah, that was kind of the mold that he wanted to build. And I think we've done a pretty good job following that in some ways. And yeah, to get to play Lowell, like that's the school I came down to, is between UMass and UMass Lowell when I was recruiting. So to get to play against them, and then ultimately to play against Duluth again was special. It was kind of like a revenge game for a lot of us.
That's just, oh man.
Good choice.
The chills.
Going to NewMass. But yeah, what does NewMass mean to you now that you've kind of, you know, you've been there for the creation of it and it kind of came full circle?
And what's next for UMass here?
Yeah. Well, NewMass.
NewMass. There. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Carvey's branding. I don't know. I mean, to me, it's kind of the entire culture. It's everything that we've created and all the work that's put into to what we've done to build a hockey program. You know, it's all the guys that have either been here and moved on to the next level or are still here and have contributed and, you know, ultimately pushed our program forward and have left the jersey in a better place than when we put it on.
It's a great answer. I mean, yeah. You guys are definitely set for the future. It's going to be hard to say no to UMass now. I know you got Makar's younger brother coming in next year and some other good recruits. But can we expect another, now I know it's going to be a repeat championship next year. Is that possible?
I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure Carvey will do everything in his power to get the team there.
That'd be good. That'd be good for hockey, another championship out East. I think that was a big one for college hockey in general, just East team winning it. Yeah. That guys, you know, that had to feel good for the hockey community out there.
Well, just being, we're from this, you know, the state of hockey, but we were just getting ripped apart. Like, there's three Minnesota teams, they don't come out with it.
Yeah, we went 0-3.
Yeah, so I mean, that was pretty big for Massachusetts.
I mean, I felt like I went 1-1 though after Saturday night. That was a pretty fun night.
Yeah,
we'll say that. It was just nuts, man.
We almost felt victorious. You know?
I mean, that just had to be the best feeling.
That night was awesome. But to be kind of under the we've been hiding basically all year, right, from COVID and everything, but to get to kind of loosen up a little bit and see a bunch of fans and celebrate that was pretty cool. But yeah, no, the Frozen Four next year, I think, is in Boston. So
yeah, it's gonna be
nuts. If they were to get back, that'd be pretty cool.
Yeah.
We'll just plan on having you on. Let's say UMass gets in the Frozen Four, do what we did with Kale this year. Can we lock you down for a pod if that happens?
Oh. Yeah, anytime. So I'm not joining the pod like full time after this one. Or
well,
like,
you are. You want,
I mean, we're not saying no at this point. We don't hold those kind of cards. But
how many picks do you have with the trophy? Because I think I have like 10, which is probably 10 too many. But you've got to have over 1,000 right now with different fans, family, players.
I got a lot. If there's anyone out there that has them, send them to me. I love getting a big camera roll full of them.
Yeah, you're a man of the people going around the room. I was like, that is a captain right there.
That's a captain.
Every single person. I didn't think I'd hold it. I was like, what am I doing with this? You know, I was scared.
But that trophy feels good, though. It has to feel even better for you. Describe the feeling when you pick it up off the table, though, and turn around and give it to the boys on the ice there.
Yeah, Yeah, so cool. Like, just to, I guess, to see the excitement on everyone's faces and to kind of share that myself, and you have the fans in the background. I blacked out a little bit. What I do remember, it was pretty special. But yeah, like, just pure joy. Like, mm-hmm. words can't really describe it. What a feeling.
Did you get to sleep with the trophy that night, or who slept with the trophy?
Ooh, it should be
you. I didn't spoon with it, but it was in my room. Yeah, it was on the desk. Yeah.
Oh, God. Just waking up to that guy. I mean, I don't care how hungover you are Sunday morning, you're good to go. That trophy on your desk.
Yeah. It's the kind of gal you want to take home tomorrow.
We've been marching that thing around all over the place. Carvey had to kind of take it away from us.
Keep it intact. That's good. That's good stuff.
I love the post game press conference where it seemed like they're kind of taking long asking you questions. You're like, I need a beer. You know, get out of there. Like, how long did that feel like for you? So you're like, I need to go out and celebrate. You know.
Yeah, well, I was answering questions. I could hear all the boys. They were walking to the bus. They had the speaker going, playing We Are the Champions. I was like, man, I got to get out.
I got to get out there. Just walk out.
Like, let's go. We're ready to play. Come on. Give me back. Yeah, I can't imagine.
Man, I was waiting for you in the lobby. I was just like, this trophy's got to come in a second. Yeah. I know you're holding it. That was a pretty – I mean, I gave DeMike a hug right away. Never met the guy in my life. I was just so happy for you guys. It was an electric feeling.
He was fired up.
The get-together on the second floor. There. Yeah, that bar made probably enough money for the year.
I meant Ben Bar.
Oh, sorry.
But yeah.
That bar in the lobby.
The lobby bar as well was present, for sure. Yeah.
I walked into the bar and UMass fans were just handing me beers. I was like, oh, God. What's going to happen tonight?
They were generous, man.
They were. No, they're happy to win. And you could tell how much that meant to everyone, not only on your team, but the fan base as well. It's, yeah, that was pretty cool experience for you guys to win that one. Do we want to go a little speed round left with them? I mean, we've already done one speed round.
What kind of speed round are we thinking?
I don't know. Just roll it off the top of our head.
Okay.
Yeah, hit me. I'm in. Let's go.
He's in.
He's ready for it.
We can just be like.
We can tell last stories too if you want. You know.
Do we have last stories?
Do you have a last story to tell? Because he'd love it if you.
I can't believe he's not even in here.
Yeah, I mean, you should just ask him about the DM game that he used to have with our friend George Mika on the team. They used to. I don't want to expose him too much, but he used to play NHL, and the loser would get to, or the winner would get to send a DM to anyone off the other person's phone. So the lines used to be pretty creative. It was like, just like messages, you know, like, hey, I'm going to Whole Foods. Like, do you want me to pick you up anything? Just really bizarre things, but they were so funny. Like, those two guys together are hysterical. Oh, they're so much fun.
Yeah, Johnny's good shit. That's, I'm going to start using that.
Yeah, let's play Michelle, man. I'm in.
Just start sending messages to everyone on his phone.
He's literally, so we have like a document where like we just write ideas for questions, and Johnny's been typing in it.
While we're going right
he
now?
He said he's working, yeah, and he's just doing that shit right now.
Why did he end this thing?
So he has one, how many times a practice do you quote a movie, is what he said, and what's your favorite? Or no, maybe that's for D-Mike. Maybe that, but you can answer it too.
Yeah, I personally don't, but same guy, George Mika on our team, our freshman year, he would almost exclusively speak in movie quotes, whether it's you know, Happy Gilmore or Dodgeball or other things. The guy's, he's a riot. And actually, Laz kind of orchestrated this. My freshman year, this is a good story.
Let's rip.
I was living in a dorm with a roommate who didn't have his suit in Amherst yet. But we had this thing. It was for a week. We were planning this formal sorority party, whatever, at the bar. And I was like, yeah, guys are talking. It's a formal. Like, we're having a formal with the sorority. I'm like, I don't know what the hell this means. Like, does this mean I have to wear a suit? My roommate's like, yeah, you got to wear your suit. Like, I'm pissed. I don't have mine, whatever. I'm like, okay. So we go over to the pregame. I'm the only guy in a suit, right?
Yeah.
Which is usually a red flag. But everyone's like, no, we're bringing them. We're going to put them on once we get to this party. I'm like, okay. So we get in the car. Sure enough, guys are all carrying their suit bags, right? They got their shoes in there, everything. I'm like, you can start to get the feeling that like, I think I'm being had here. But these guys have their suits. So like, maybe they're just putting them on. They wouldn't be messing with me that badly. And sure enough, yeah, walk in the party. The door opens. Everyone's just laughing. I'm the only guy wearing a suit, just rocking it. But I'm pretty sure Laz was the one of the masterminds behind that entire thing.
I gotta watch out for Laz now.
Yeah, that's like the 9-3-9 trick.
Yeah,
in Happy Gilmore.
That's just me.
Were they in flip flops or something, or what? how drastic was it?
Pretty well. I mean, just normal going out clothes, just bringing the suits for to keep the joke going.
Yeah, I mean, you had to be the sharpest looking one there, though. That's an icebreaker.
My only regret is I Ubered home like within 5 minutes. I was there and back in normal clothes, like nothing happened.
You should have just kept it on at that point.
I should have rocked it for sure. Yeah.
Let it run.
Oh,
that is trying to think about that. What was one of his? Yeah, he just said respect the Atlantic. I don't know if that's a question.
He just threw that.
Respect it. Okay. All right. Fair enough. Oh, that was one question I was going to ask Makar, and I didn't. Is like, were you? I guess I can say as well. Ever tempted to join him and go to Mercyhurst? You know, start a revolution.
No,
over there.
No, he said
no. No, I wasn't. I'm pretty happy here.
Yeah, good choice.
Yeah.
I'm so excited for him to listen to this part.
Yeah. I remember him too. Obviously, he's got his fake teeth. He used to pop them out. You go to look at your drink when you're at a party, and he'd stuck his teeth into your drink. So you go down to take a sip.
That's like, soaked.
Yeah.
That is nasty. Does he even have fake teeth now?
He just got him screwed in today. He sent me a snap with screws in his mouth. It's like, God.
Oh, nice. Nice.
Like, I've seen him with the
biggest. Don't expose him too bad here with these stories, but.
Yeah, I'll pick and choose. He deserves some of these.
He deserves, he has a good amount coming to him.
Yeah, we'll rip him.
Okay. What's your plan for school, though? Obviously, you're still going to be playing hockey here, but are you finishing off your degree, or have you finished school, or what's up?
I got one. I'm actually in one class this semester. So,
that's what you told me.
I got like a group project left, and I think that's pretty much it. So I'm close to the end.
Did the group just like, oh, you want it all? Don't worry about it. We'll take care. You know,
I got a great group. There's a bunch of like really fun guys, and they're big fans of the team. So it's actually been a lot of fun to work with them.
Oh, it sounds like you're good.
Understanding that we've been gone in Pittsburgh.
Yeah, you guys are busy bringing home some hardware.
Yeah, obviously. Absolutely.
And like, I mean, does it feel good that you're never have to buy a beer again in Amherst? Is that gotta be a good feeling?
Yeah. I mean, hey, I'm happy to pay for them, but if they're on someone else too, I'll still drink them.
In this economy, I mean, it'd be rude to turn it down. Yeah, it's like, I'll take it in for the boys.
What are you gonna miss most about college hockey in your time at UMass though?
Just the boys. I feel like you'll never be closer with a group of guys.
Yeah.
We do, we do court all the time and find each other. I think that's one of the most fun times of the week. But just like the silly pranks too, I think are always hilarious. And just being able to, I don't know, you go eat with these guys all the time. You have class with them. You see them at the rink. You're just close all the time. It's like just a bunch of brothers.
Yeah.
What was the last fine that you got in court?
Ooh, that's a good question.
Good question. I honestly don't know. The seniors did a pretty good job just washing all the fines that came our way this year.
Brushing them off. Ah.
Yeah. I used to get fined I think I fell in warm up like once every five games from freshman to junior year. I would just go out there and just fly around too hard in warm ups. I hid from all those fines. I had no warm up falls this year, which is actually a big accomplishment, I think.
Atta boy. That might have been what turned the tide for the boys. just clean skating out there. Wow. Okay. What about Laz? What was his? His fines. I can't imagine.
I can't imagine. Just.
Yeah, I don't even know. He would always. We have a little like fine jar where you put notes in that are like anonymous fines. So he would fill that jar up with just like hilarious, like just stuff you wouldn't even think of. Like it'd be so out of left field.
I can see him doing it right now.
Yeah.
The guy's just hilarious.
That'd be his favorite part. They're like getting ready for a big matchup and he's just over there in the corner writing fines for the boys.
When a guy would get fined, he'd be like, all right, who wrote this? And no one would say anything. Lass would just be like giggling in the corner.
He's just there to have a good time.
He's, like, he's a locker room guy. You need that
absolute,
guy.
Absolute, yeah, glue guy. Hanging out there. We got to get some fines going for the boys here.
Yeah.
Like Wendy, not even watching right now.
He's working. Yep. He's working on his stuff. He's working on his
We got guys doing homework in here.
What else do we want to ask him while he's on quick? We got a couple minutes.
I know you're listening, babe. You're all right. It's nice.
Fine, God's there. Oh, I do have one question. I'm assuming you've listened to Carr's interview on Spit and Chicklets. What would you rate that interview?
I was pretty impressed. I haven't listened to all of it yet. I'm saving it for tomorrow. I give him like maybe an 8.2, 8.3.
8.2?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not bad. Yeah, he came out. I mean, he answered everything just.
Yeah, he is. He's not afraid to speak his mind.
Yeah,
I'll say that.
Did not seem hungover. Like it seemed like he was like back and ready to work. Like,
I think he turned the page on Monday. He was back to getting ready for next season.
That's what you want in a coach. Yeah, it must That's be what nice. You want.
Again, Jake, we just want to thank you for your time today, man. We were so fired up to be there for the ship and
the after party too, man. The after party was fun. Thanks a lot for taking the pictures with
that
us.
Was fun to have you guys. Awesome.
That video might still pop up of me just tossing you a beer right when you walk in the hotel. Oh, that's a legendary video.
We'll work it in deep.
that was Hall of Fame. Yeah,
that was great, man. Everyone loved that, and the picture is great. But best of luck with your pro career here. We'll stay in touch, but again, that is your national champion, the captain of UMass Amherst here. Thanks, Jake.
Thank you. Appreciate you guys.
All right. Welcome back. So joining us now, we have a former RIT Steel Curtain and current associate head coach of your Natty Champs. It's UMass. We got Jared DeMichiel with us. DeMike, how's it going?
Going good, boys. Had a, not going to lie, pretty eventful weekend here. Still living on a little bit of a high, but no, thanks for having me. Excited to be here.
Yeah. What's the story been like at UMass since you've got back to town there?
Yeah. I mean, being in my mid-30s is probably not as sweet as it is for the guys right now. Yeah. I'm sure you guys might have seen when we arrived on Sunday. It was pretty crazy. Definitely found that there was going to be a gathering when we got back to the Mullen Center, to our arena. And we thought it was going to be low-key. And like, we're driving into campus and you can see like cars lining up and people lining up and people are honking horns and you can start to see UMass shirts and logos. And then we take a corner to go on Mullen Center Way. And literally there's just like a wave of people, and you like, you don't see grass or pavement. All you see is people after people. Like, they ended up like walking up to the bus. The bus was at like just crawling, but we opened up the bus driver told us we could open up the windows. People are like giving us high fives. People tossed a few things into the bus for the boys to enjoy themselves. But it was nice. Crazy. It was awesome. And I think the guys have been enjoying themselves as they should. Obviously, whatever, with COVID times, you got to be smart about that. But
yeah.
Whatever, it's a once in a lifetime opportunity to win a national championship. The first in UMass history. And as you guys, you never forget your first.
Yeah. No doubt. I mean, that's huge for this school and your first national championship as well. But how is your perspective as a coach different than the players, would you say, of winning a national championship?
No, I mean, it's definitely special. I mean, going to the Frozen Four as a player, not a big deal.
Yeah.
losing the national championship a couple of years ago, and even Carvey gave some perspective on it. But like, you, when you don't win it and you get there and you get just a small taste of it, like you never forget that feeling. And obviously, whatever, playing in Duluth in the semifinal, they are an unbelievable team. Mm-hmm. And I thought they played really, really well. And I think we got some bounces to go our way. But to think about that team the last few years, like, we definitely wanted an opportunity to go up against them. And then in the national championship game against St. Cloud, like, they're another great team. And I think we got some good bounces and the guys were super opportunistic, but to have that lead in the third period and to kind of be able to look around and soak it in, and Carve pulled the guys in with at the last TV timeout and was like, "Hey, like, you guys, you're all national champions. Like, you have that with you for the rest of your life." And you could see the smile on the kids' faces. And, obviously it's super special, but like, with it being the COVID year, I think it means even more just the amount of sacrifice that our guys had to do on a daily basis with all the testing and social distancing and not seeing their parents and not seeing their girlfriends. And, everybody's gone through, but it's just not the real life. And hopefully you get to the real life here sooner rather than later.
I've seen a lot of people on Twitter talking about this season being like a Disney movie for UMass. Shout out to one guy, Nate Wells specifically, but I mean, just from being there from the start, when you guys came in as a coaching staff, like the first meeting, you guys said, like, "I want to be like UMass Lowell, like play to their identity." And you guys beat Lowell in Hockey East. Like, it's almost fitting that you took down Lowell, the team you kind of wanted to be when you first came to UMass, and then you beat Duluth, who beat you guys 2 years ago. It's like a very fitting, like, movie-esque kind of win, I feel like.
Yeah, no, I mean, I don't know if poetic justice is the right word and whatnot, but I mean, Laz, you were a part of it, and you were a helpful piece of our program moving forward and things like that. But I mean, you saw it, Laz, and our guys still have it. Like, we have a serious chip on our shoulder. People still doubt us. I mean, you see those everything college hockey polls, everything every single week. We can't even crack the top five. I mean, I don't want to put words in our players' mouth, but I mean, for me personally, I still have a chip on my shoulder, and I don't think a lot of people expected us to win this season, let alone win the national championship. And you got to use that as fuel and motivation. But we feel like we're arguably one of the top programs in the country, and we're not going to change who we are just off of success. I think that's when you can kind of go sideways. We know what our identity is. We know what our values are. And we're not going to change any of our philosophies. We want to continue to get better in what we do. But we know what our sweet spot is, and we want to keep trying to hammer that home and get better and better. But just like you said, Laz, like, it did feel a little bit like a Disney movie where these seniors came in after our first year, that was really pretty rough. And they had to go through some tough things, but then whatever, we win the Hockey East Championship, but then we go through the regional, and after the regional, one of our guys tests positive. That takes out all of his roommates. Yeah. So then people are doubting us even more. And it was just a shot at our culture. Where are we at? How are we going to handle this? And I think it was kind of a rallying cry for our guys to come together. Like, hey, like, we got to find a way to win a game on Thursday night so we can get the band back together, get the boys back here. But even crazy too, like, I think originally the plan was to fly those three guys in. And then we found that out that like the CDC had them on a no fly zone. And they were like, oh, they can just get in the same car. Like, they're in the same car and one of them tests positive and they're all out. So they all had to take separate cars. Like, I FaceTimed with Philae and a couple of the other guys just to check and see how they were doing. But that's like, whatever, an 8-9 hour drive. And they hadn't been practicing. And then they just had a pregame skate on Saturday and hop on the ice. Like, you know what, Laz, it's not easy. But I think it's an example of our culture, an example of our character and our commitment. And no, it was awesome. It was cool.
How much does it mean?
I just wanted to add one thing quick, boys, if I can.
Yeah, go.
Well, just because it starts from the top down when you're building a culture. And I don't think there's many other coaching staffs out there that are doing 6 a.m. workouts for the boys. I know you guys do.
No, I think you know this, Laz. We're all about Furta. We're all about for the boys. And you may not see it. I mean, this is a good camera angle. You can't see my barrel from here down. So I like this camera shot. But no, I mean, we're not going to ask anything different of our players than what we'd ask for ourselves. And obviously there's a higher level of commitment from the players with their nutrition and things like that. And they're working out, but I knew it from being a player. I did not want to be, when I was in college, I did not want to be up at 5 a.m., 6 a.m. working out. And we had to do that our first spring. And it was kind of like, hey, if you guys are going to do it, we're going to be there every single day for you as much as we really don't want to be up early in the morning too. And we still do. I still hop in with the lifts with the guys now and things like that. But we're lucky now that whatever, we have a brand new shiny weight room and we're actually renovating the locker room. I was walking through the demo today. It's pretty sweet. It's like an episode of HGTV walking through that. But it's definitely satisfying seeing how everything has grown. But it also puts ownership like, hey, like, we want to make this thing even better. And people are going to come after us now and we got to be even better at what we do.
Yeah, Coach, how big of a recruiting tool is it now that you got that national championship trophy? You just mentioned it there, the new locker room. We talked with Makar about it a couple of weeks ago, that new locker room. How big of a recruiting piece is that for you guys to keep building on your dynasty here?
No, it definitely helps. And like Laz saw in our first recruiting class, like what we have now compared to have what we have back then, like it's crazy. But we ask a lot of our players and ask a lot of them. We feel like this is rewarding and they've earned this. But we do not want to lose that blue collar, that lunch pail personality by any means. Like, obviously, it's going to be great to have a nice new locker room and new lounge and kitchen area and recovery area. And it can enhance our daily development of our players, the daily unity of our players. And I do think it's definitely going to help in recruiting. But you'd be surprised how many kids kind of still look past us. And we're okay with that. We're like, we want the kids that want to be a part of this. And Kale McCarr, perfect example. He wanted to be a part of this. Like, he was all on board. Even when the coaching staff changed and we came in, he was all on board. Like, I know you guys had Jake Gaudet on this. Like, God's visited campus. And he loved it. He was all on board. And Zach Jones just signed the other day. A lot of guys that we recruit are kind of under the radar, but they're just like, hey, like, this is where I want to be. This is where I want to be coached. This is where I want to be pushed. And that just kind of works for us. So I do think it could open up some doors recruiting wise, and we still want to be one of the best programs in the country, but we're not going to totally switch with how we do things. Cause I think that's how you can kind of lose your identity, and that's not what we're worried about.
Well, one guy, you mentioned guys we had on the pod. We also had on Matt Murray. Was it last season or last off season? I believe.
Yeah. Off season.
So how hard was that decision? Like, he came in and played against UMD, got his 52nd win, I think, of his college career. How hard was it to, you know, go back to Philae, who, you know, didn't have the chance to play because of COVID protocols? Yeah. You know, how hard was that decision to make?
No, it was super, super tough. Like, Matt is, he's a really, really good goalie, and he's really grown as a person. I called my wife and talked to her about it. Just, I was struggling just because he really stepped up for the team, for not playing for such a long period of time. And for a goalie, just mentally, like, to shake that rust off into the national semifinal against Duluth. And I really didn't think he missed a beat. Philae was just, had such a great second half and kind of forced our hand. But I give Mers so much credit. Like when we pulled him in and let him know what our decision was, his only response was, "Coach, I'll be ready." Mm-hmm. And he had all the right in the world to be upset, to be frustrated, to be mad. And when he said, "Coach, I'll be ready," like I was like, "Oh my God, like I would take a bullet for this kid right now." You know what
Disney.
I mean?
Sure. That's
and speaking of gods, I know he's been on here. Yeah. He's a huge advocate of getting pucks in deep. Like that's what that kid does for a living.
Yeah.
But I actually want to give a funny story on him recruiting wise. And I think he talked about it a little bit, but when we were recruiting him at whatever CCHL showcase was down there talking to him. I think I was the only Division I school talking to him. Like I looked left, I looked right. Like it was all Division III schools. I was like, was I smoking peyote, like watching him skate? Like this kid's really good. Like, why is there nobody else down here talking to him? So I had a good conversation with him. And the next weekend I was like, "Hey, like we're going to keep an eye on you. I'm going to come back up in 2 weeks." The next weekend he broke his ankle. Broke your ankle, like you're out 6 months. And to his credit, like he really rehabbed really hard, but like every 2 or 3 weeks would just check in with him. Hey, Jake, how's it going? How's your ankle doing? How's rehab going? And then he got closer to coming back and I was like, "Hey, like you should come down and see things. Team's not the best right now, but you got to trust me, like take a leap of faith. We got a good coaching staff. We're building a good culture. You can be a part of this." And he came down and saw things and he hadn't even come back to play yet. And there was another school that was just like, basically whatever, asking him for a decision. He's like, "Hey coach, like I really, really want to come to UMass. This other school is a great option too, but I would be kicking myself if I didn't call you and talk to you before making a decision." And when he called me, I called Coach Carville and I was like, "Hey, like we want to offer this kid. We want to get it done." And he was like, "Yeah, offer him, do whatever you got to do. Just get it done." And I mean, ended up being our captain, ended up going to the Frozen Four twice and ended up winning the national championship his senior year. And knock on wood here, I think he's going to sign a pro contract here within the next few days. And we're super, super excited for him and a great honor for him and his family.
Yeah, definitely well-deserved, I think. Obviously for me, I have a little bit of a bias having him on the podcast, but for me, watching him in the Frozen Four, that kid backchecked harder than everyone ever seen before. And he won every battle. I mean, yeah, what a leader.
Doesn't lose a battle.
And then meeting him after, we've had him on the podcast, like I said, but meeting him after the game with the trophy, just the nicest kid. You probably couldn't ask for a better leader out of Jake.
Sure. He's like, he's got a lot going for him. Like, yeah. Canadian, but he's basically like a Greek god. Like he's big, he's chiseled. He's a really good student. Like he's a lights out student, mm-hmm. but great character, hard worker. He's a good athlete. I mean,
he's on business.
Yeah. Eisenberg School of Business. Like literally, like he's got everything going for him. Like I think he's got a girlfriend right now. I don't know if I can share that in the podcast, but
we met her this weekend.
He was a single man. Like girls, like look out, like you got a 10 out of 10 there with him.
No, great guy. And that goes for a lot of your guys. We met a lot of the guys at the after party there, just a bunch of good guys. You can tell the chemistry is very high in the room. I mean, just first class guys all around that we got to meet. So
I think that first class starts with the coaching staff and comes down to the players.
That's fair.
we got a chance to meet your dad. I swear we saw your dad every single day in Pittsburgh. It was like he was, I think he brought the spark, the luck charm for the boys there. I don't know.
My wife, Kara, she talks about this all the time. And my mom knows this too. But my dad and I, like we both have this weird ability just to bump into people and make friends with people. And you guys were the only people. Like I got a million text messages and emails. There was like a restaurant owner in Pittsburgh that met my dad and he got my email address. He's like, "Hey, like we'll have you for post game meal. I talked to your dad. Like he says you like Italian. Here's our house." He bumped into you guys. He's just like a social butterfly, but it was really, really cool for my dad to be a part of that. Like, obviously I didn't play in the game. I was just a coach standing on the bench, trying to look good and yell and scream every once in a while, but, satisfying for him to be around hockey for so long. And he's not a huge hockey guy. He loves the game and things like that, but definitely satisfying for him. Like he sacrificed a lot for me growing up and then super supportive of me when I was a duster getting cut by teams growing up. Was struggling to try to get a Division I coaching job and super, super supportive. And he actually just had both his knees replaced.
He mentioned that.
Yeah, I mean, you could probably tell he was walking. He looked like he was moving slower than molasses. But no, it was cool for him. He's a social butterfly. He's freaking got a really nice tan going right now. He's
that too. Still driving
down in Florida. But no, I'm excited to see him when he comes back north here.
How about back to the family here? You know, you just won a championship, so congrats on that. But you just also welcomed your second child in the world. Jordan, I believe, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
Congrats. But what is the feeling like? You know, you just another child and national championship to go with it. What's that like?
No, it's crazy. Like, so after we played Lake State and Bemidji in the regional in Bridgeport, both Coach Barr and I, both of our wives were pregnant at that time. Coach Barr's wife is still pregnant right now with twins, actually. But we both drove down to Bridgeport in case our wives popped and we had to drive back north to Amherst. But luckily, they were both fine. Get back after the game that Saturday night. Like, I'm just gassed from the games trying to prepare for those two teams and really two really tough games to play. Get home, just whatever, throw down the bags, trying to unpack and talking to my wife. And she's like, so like, how are we going to handle things here? Like, this baby's like due here pretty soon. I'm like, yeah. And I'm like, well, like, you know, we got a couple weeks between games. Like, let's just wait and see. And she's like, well, like, you're not going anywhere until this thing's born. I'm like, come on. Like, and then no joke, like, I don't know if the hockey gods were looking down on us or what, but like 5 minutes later, she's like, what's going on in my stomach? I'm like, don't mess around. Like, it's freaking midnight. I want to go to sleep. I'm gassed. Like, let's go. No, like, something's funky going on. She like pops up and she's like, my water just broke. I'm like, if you're trolling me right now, this is the worst troll ever. But her water broke. We headed down to the hospital. And she had her baby boy, Jordan Christopher, like 8 hours later. And, she's a badass, went like no drugs, no help. She did the same thing with our daughter, Paige Elise. And, no, super happy. I met my wife in college at RIT. So she's been, through a lot with me and been very super supportive. And, she was disappointed. She didn't get to be in Pittsburgh like you guys were. So she's a little jealous, but, I actually snuck my phone out for the post game on the ice and was FaceTiming her. She was actually feeding Jordan. So hopefully we get some skates on him in the near future. We show him how to get pucks in deep.
Yeah.
All those.
I think that picture is going to be pretty special when you get one with the kids and the trophy and everything. So, but again, congrats. We hope both kids are healthy and things are looking up for you guys.
Let's get them eating pucks as soon as possible. You know. 2-3 years old, whatever it takes.
Start block shooting pucks at your kids.
You got to learn sometime, you know?
Like, hey, start them while they're young. You know?
Yeah. Like, suit them up like in Big Daddy, give them the catcher's gear and just start ripping them in the infield, you know? let them take a few. Be good to go.
Maybe a little slap shot regatta, you know?
Why the hell not? Let's go. Holy shit. Now I lost my track for a question. Johnny, you say something. You've been quiet.
Okay, I'll say something. I hate when you guys do this to me.
We can edit it out.
I mean, well, just going back to UMass and everything, DeMike, I mean, everyone I think here has listened to Carb's interview on Chicklets, and he touched on NewMass a little bit, but what does NewMass mean to you? Because I think there's still a lot of people who don't understand what NewMass is and the meaning behind it.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think a lot of people too, and I can see why. Like, I know they may be get annoyed maybe when we tweet it out when they're like, oh, it's not new, it's been whatever 5 years, shut up. But I think just it's a different mentality, it's a different identity, it's something different to be associated with. When like in Carve, that story that Carve told on Chicklets, that's exactly how he came up with it. And it was kind of weird, like, whatever, we just lost the recruit and we were told, whatever, because of that situation, he didn't want to come to UMass. And we're going down the elevator to talk to the players. And he's like, gosh, like, we're not that, we're NewMass. Like, that's who we are. We're NewMass. Like, we're new, we're different. Like, we've got a different mentality. Like, screw that. And then he came in and talked to the guys. I think when he said it to the guys were like, you know, like, I don't really know what to think of it, but it kind of grew. And, but we're proud of it. Cause we do. And I think it's across the board at UMass, where 10, 15 years ago, like, UMass is a different school now than what it was then. And I think academically, and Laz can attest to this, the academic standards have grown substantially. And, the support staff, the student support staff that we have working for our team, like, when I asked them about what their high school GPAs and their SATs were, it's like, oh, coach, I had a 3.8 and I was a 1390 SAT. And I'm like, holy crap. Like, those are really good. There's a lot of kids that are like that. And, the school has really put a lot of money and effort into growing the school. And it, like, whatever, you can look at our hockey facilities, but the same thing on campus. It's much easier for me to walk around a student and to show them Eisenberg and to show them our new student union, to show them the Honors College, to show them new buildings on campus. The Worcester Dining Hall just got redone. Things are really, really improving here, and it's not changing. And sometimes, whatever, new doesn't always mean good, but new is kind of a fresh mindset, a fresh identity. And that's what it means to us. And it's special. Like, we do, we like the new mass rallying cry. And when people don't like it, it gives us even more motivation to try to beat them and try to prove them wrong.
I like that.
I remember one specific video session where, like, Carve had found out, like, some of the guys ordered like $50 worth of Wendy's or something the night before. And he was showing video of guys, like, not going stick on puck and, like, hitting with their sticks in the air. And just, like, he would yell at one clip, "ZooMass!" And then the next clip was, like, a good play, "NewMass!" Like, just going back and forth. It was so funny. I remember that. That was
Well, I totally remember that too. And I think sometimes too, like, anything we did anything well there the first couple years, like a clip in the top right corner, just say "NewMass, NewMass, NewMass."
I think every one of our rankings without you guys in the top five was ZooMass. Then we fucked up. Son of a bitch.
Hey, I'm not gonna lie. I had fun on Insta chirping you guys, and I know Laz would see that. I had fun, you know, like. We never cracked your top five. We won the national championship. Yeah. I feel like you're getting dogged.
You're number one now. That's all that matters, yeah, right?
You got to post a new one.
With everything college hockey, like, they kind of like those Midwest schools a little bit more than the Eastern schools.
I mean, it's tough. I went to Bemidji State. He went to UMD. Beat us both. I mean,
you cost us both a bit of money. Road, so. Say that. Yeah.
My bad.
No, you made it up. You also made up for it Saturday night, though. We were betting UMass heavy. So that was nice. The over didn't hit. I'll say that. That kind of stung. But otherwise, good performance, you know. But one question I had listening to Carve's interview is, he mentioned, like, his pro coaching experience kind of helped land McCarr. But, like, is that something that goalies that are looking for recruiting, they see your, you know, pro experience? You went to the Frozen Four with RIT. Has that, you know, helped you land guys like Philae, like Matt Murray? In the locker room there?
No, for sure. And I agree with Carve. Like, I do think, and it was the same way at St. Lawrence working with Coach Carvel. Yeah. His NHL background, I think, is second to none in college hockey. But he's on the younger side from working in the NHL. Like, he was working in the NHL in his 30s and early 40s. And that's a hard thing to do. And he's extremely talented, extremely gifted. But yeah, with Cale, I think that was a huge selling piece. And I'll never forget too, like, he's taking the job at UMass, and he's like, "What's the deal with the recruits here? What can you tell me about them?" And I'm like, "This McCarr kid is sweet." He's like, "Really? Like, what's sweet mean?" I'm like, he's nasty. Like, he'll come in the freshman and he's going to be really good." And he's like, "Well, what are you going to do about it?" I'm like, "I'll get on a plane tomorrow, Carve. Talk to you then." Flew right out there. They were in the RBC Cup, got to meet Cale, build a relationship with him there. And that was important. That's how we do things, whether if it's face to face or, and Laz can attest this too with recruiting, like, we text, we email, we Snapchat, we FaceTime, we Zoom, with our committed guys. Like, we want to build a relationship, and it's different. Like, we're not calling the kids and telling them what they want to hear. Like, we're very honest with them. Sometimes it's just, "Hey, coach hasn't talked to you in a little bit. Like, what's going on? How's everything going? We've watched some of your games on hockey TV, or just saw this. Like, how's your family doing?" But yeah, my background, I do think, helps a little bit on the goalie side. Obviously was lucky enough to play Division I, lucky enough to play in the American League East Coast League, went to a couple NHL training camps. So that helps. And like, whatever, speaking of Philae and whatnot, like, he was not highly recruited. When we actually recruited him, like, I can remember coaches being like, "He's not a full scholarship goalie," or, "He's a backup in Hockey East." And I was like, "All right, like, you guys have your opinion. Like, I have my opinion." But with crazy too, with Philae, we actually only watched him online. Coach Barr had a contact in Finland, sent him some video, and Benny got the video, looked at it. He's like, "DeMike's like, I'm not the goalie guy. You need to look at this, but I think this kid's really good." And I watched like five shots. I'm like, "This kid's nasty. Like, he's our guy. He's the guy that we got to get." And I think we locked him up shortly thereafter. But even he got to campus, and he was really good. And there was a really good battle there between him and Matt Murray. And it definitely needed a lot of massaging and things like that. But I think they both made each other better at the end of the day. But I feel like we're pretty progressive with all of our skill development, and that includes our goalies. Like we do at least two goalie specific practices before practice for at least 30 minutes. We film all those. I break them down. We go over it with the goalies. We film all their shots. Sometimes I'll send them clips of NHL goalies and anything that we can do to make our players better. And sometimes I'll be hitting something home and they might be like, yeah, DeMike, like beat it. Like I got this figured out. I'll send them a clip of an NHL goalie. I'll be like, well, DeMike's not as dumb as he looks, huh?
He's figuring it out.
Oh, hey, well, we'll take Phil and we'll take him here in Minnesota. So whenever you guys want to hand him back over to us.
After another natty ship, maybe.
We'll see. How many movie quotes a practice would you say that you do? Over 5.5 or under?
Ooh.
Oof, way over 5.5.
I was going to say. Yeah. Especially the Happy Lookout. That's your go-to, right?
Yeah. No, I'd say Happy Gilmore's up there a lot. Dumb and Dumber. Anchorman. those are a lot of the go-tos. I try to mix in some new ones here every once in a while, too. But Kale McCarr is a huge Marvel Comics Avengers guy. Him and I would talk about those movies a lot too. Actually, Mario Ferraro is big into it too.
Oh, so, yeah.
Yeah, but yeah. Big into movie quotes. My wife still to this day, she gets annoyed every time I say something. When she doesn't understand what I'm saying, she knows it's a movie quote, but when the boys are over, they get it. So I'm going to hopefully hand off the baton to Jordan. He's all into the movie quotes too.
Yeah, you got to build. Yeah. You kind of got to know your audience, but yeah, once you have one person laughing, that's Johnny in our group. He rips quotes all day. James doesn't know shit.
Yeah. I'm not a movie guy.
He's top notch with the movie quotes too.
That's why you picked me for the golf cart and the golf outing. They wanted you to tell that story with the.
Oh no. Let's hear
it. Can we tell the golf story?
Is it
is that possible?
Do you remember that? The marshmallows?
You tell the golf story, Laz.
Okay, so I got handpicked to be in the golf cart with DeMike for the UMass golf outing. And we're both guys who like to, you know, have a good time, keep it light. So DeMike goes, yo, I got a bag of marshmallows. I'm going to leave it on the course. So the guys behind us think it's their ball. So at the end of the day, like, you know, these people are picking up. We dropped a whole bag of marshmallows. These people are getting pissed behind us. At the end of the day, it was just so funny. I was cracking up. Like, thank God I was with you, you know, because I feel like, I don't know. I feel like if I was behind you, I'd have been pretty pissed too, but it was a good time. Couldn't go to the other end.
What's funny, Les, is we still do that golf outing as a team, and I don't do the marshmallow thing anymore, but like one guy every year like remembers it, and they'll still be like marshmallows. And it's great where like guy walks up to the green, like thinks he's got to tap it, and he's like, freaking marshmallow. Like, God damn it, I hate that pop.
Don't test me, Bob. Now is not the time. I love that. Just a full bag of marshmallows. I'd be losing my shit. What about one thing I want to ask you about, like Carville's social media game the last few days has been top notch. Like he's posting GIFs tonight. Like are you behind that or is it actually him coming into his own? I don't know.
He's his own man on social media. And he's got a sneaky good personality. Like he's reserved and, If you don't know him, sometimes you think he's kind of stoic and whatnot, but behind closed doors, he's very personable. He is a sneaky, funny dude. I think he needs to give himself more credit. But even like with hopping on Chicklets, like he was like, hey, like, what do you think? I'm like, you got to go on it, Carv. Like recruiting and things like that will be huge. It'll be awesome.
Yeah.
I saw like the gif of him running.
Yeah.
After that was amazing. Beat Bemidji there. And that was like totally natural. And like, he thought it'd just be hilarious to like run like Forrest Gump. Like, I don't know how that came to him, but people will be talking about that for years to come. And he's very witty, like via text and via email and on social media. Like when he can take his time and thinks about stuff, like he's a super, super smart guy. Like back in the day, he was an Ivy level student. So he's way smarter than I ever was, but he's sneaky good on there and he can throw some jabs. Sometimes we got to tell him to pull the reins back a little bit. Like he might, when we first got to UMass, like people would make comments and like, he would go back at him. We're like, hey, Carv, like, no, like we don't really need that here. Like that guy's got 5 followers. Like his picture doesn't even have a picture. Like you don't need to say anything to that guy. Just leave him alone.
That is a good point though. I think being on Chicklets is huge for recruiting. Like all the college hockey players, all the juniors players see that. Yeah, everyone sees that. Easily. It's huge. And I think, you know, to add on to that, you guys have one of the best social medias in college hockey. Your pictures are amazing. It's, I mean, it is a recruiting piece. Social media is a huge recruiting piece as we progress here in the hockey world.
Totally. I mean, the kids nowadays, and you guys are no different. I think you're doing a great job spreading everything college hockey.
Thank you.
But the younger generation, like they're all over social media, and obviously we want to get the we want to spread that NewMass gospel all over the place, all over the world. And we spend a lot of time with our sports information, and just like we push our players, I feel like sometimes we push them, like, hey, like, what new videos can we come out with and what things can we post? And obviously you want to put content out there, but I think it needs to be respectful. I think there are some schools that will start some social media chirps. I feel like we try to stay out of that type of thing. But no, I mean, when the younger 15, 16, 17 year olds come through and they say, hey, like we saw that video on Kale McCarr, or hey, we saw that Connor Sheary just re-signed with Washington today through your social media. Like, that's kudos to them. That's our sports information doing a great job. And they're an asset to us, just like winning hockey games. It's full thing. When turn around our program, Carve's obviously done an unbelievable job, but our president, our athletic director, coaching staff, our strength coach, our trainer, our equipment manager, our student managers, our analytics workers, our rink, our guy that works our rink, like, all those things are super, super helpful. And it's all encompassing if you want to have an elite program. And you can't cut corners at the end of the day. You got to do everything right.
Yeah, you got
the alumni have been huge too.
No, the alumni has been great. And I think it's been good to get them back on board. I think it's been helpful that like I actually played with a decent amount of UMass alums, whether that was at Avon Old Farms or in juniors or in pro. Coach Barr has some buddies that he was friends with coming in. And Coach Carville knew some guys and things like that. Obviously, whatever, he actually got his master's from UMass, so he had a connection. But when we came in, like we tried to bring people in and let them know, hey, like, we're family, and there's going to be some bad times, but there's also going to be some good times. And the support that we've gotten from alumni and things like that, it's great to see. And I really, really respect the guys that were there for us since day one. Like, I think of a guy like TD, Tom Doherty, he's been super, super supportive of us, and he likes to have a good time. You guys might have saw him wheeling around in Pittsburgh. He's flying the flag. But people him really make it special. And I mean, singling him out, he's been great, but there's a lot of different people that we can meet. And turning around our facilities, like we needed the support with our weight room, and right now with our locker room, like that's not taxpayers' money. We're not getting that from the Massachusetts resident. Like, we all fundraised for that. And it's an over $2 million project. And a lot of that money has come from alumni. And I think they've really bought into understanding, like, hey, if we want to be a premier program, these are the things. It's an arms race. And that's what you have to do to keep up with the Joneses. And we're not going to change our identity again. But these things, this is something that we need. And this is something that our players, they've earned it. Like, they've earned it from all their sacrifice. And future players are going to have to continue to sacrifice. But it's something that we're really helpful and optimistic, and we're excited for the future.
Is that room done this off season? Locker room?
Yeah,
it is.
No, so we got off the bus on Sunday. They already started to take down branding Monday morning at 7 a.m. It was like HGTV making an open concept. They were just sledgehammering stuff, ceilings coming down, walls coming down.
Let's go. We need video of that.
Yeah. No, it's funny you say that. I've actually sent some videos to recruits being like, hey, you want to be part of this thing? Like, we're going to give you the after picks. And I sent some Snapchats to Kale McCarr and to Mario Ferraro, John Leonard, Mitchell Chafee, even a legend like Kurt, a.k.a. Billy Keats. He got some videos. But we don't just – obviously, Kale's super high profile, but a guy like Kurt Keats, for me, he's just as valuable to our team, and no different this year. Obviously, we had some guys that got a lot of attention, all Americans, but a guy like for me, George Mika is just as valuable to our program and to our culture as our guy that are maybe getting the awards at the end of the day. A guy like George, really great for him. Awesome senior year. The kid's got a lot going for him. It was awesome to see a guy like him have an awesome senior year. Just like the same thing for Kirk Keith. I think it was great for him to play in the Frozen Four.
Yeah. You mentioned like,
he always comes up on here.
He has every time.
We got to get him on.
We do.
But like you mentioned, like sending videos of, you know, former players or just like guys that you're trying to recruit right now, you know, going on the locker room. Like what does your off season look like right now? Like, are you back in the office Monday morning, you know, firing off, like, you know, studying film or ready to recruit, or like, what's that? Like, I feel like there's no rest for you guys.
Yeah, no, I think some people, I mean, it's different for our players. I think they're they're living a rock star life. They're walking down red carpets. They're having a grand old time. They're getting freaking roses thrown at them when they walk through campus. But for our coaches, I mean, I think we got our heads snapped on straight pretty fast when we found that Zach Jones was looking to sign. So, like we want to have another really strong season. So, I mean, we were back in the office basically 8 a.m. on Monday, trying to figure out our roster, trying to get an idea of our players that are coming and going and things like that. And we're optimistic that we're not going to have a ton of roster turnover, but we understand when we have success and win games and players develop, like we want them to develop, they're going to have the opportunity to sign contracts, and we're fully supportive of that, but we're also fully supportive of how we're going to develop. And we're very supportive of the college model. But basically this week, since 8 a.m. Monday morning, like we've been focused on our team and researching players that maybe we need for the fall. Also we're kind of doing player exit meetings right now just to kind of be all on the same page. Hey, this is what we saw for this season. This is what we want for next season. And I think maybe once we get our roster kind of solidified, maybe we can be able to soak in it a little bit. But my wife will tell you, I haven't really slept well the last few nights. I'm a little antsy until I'm very big on organization. It may not come across that way. Coach Barr calls me, instead of OCD, he calls me OCD Mike. So I'm big on, as in, once our roster, we get the right amount of forwards, defensemen, and goalies, then I'll be able to sleep a little bit easier, and then maybe I'll have a couple cold ones here.
There we go.
Well-deserved.
I mean, we could throw you back on, we'll make a new rankings so you can sleep better. We'll put you at number one.
I think if I comment, I'll just be like, finally.
Yeah, that's it.
Boom.
That's it. We'll take it. We'll also take some help with funding to get out there. We want to shoot a video for you guys. I don't know if you've seen our game day experience videos for other schools. We did NODAC this year, Minnesota, Wisconsin. But I think you guys in the new locker room, we got to show that thing off to all our fans and get it out there. I mean, NewMass is here, but we'd love to come shoot a game day experience video next year for you guys. Totally. That's allowed. Yeah.
Hopefully things are back to normal.
Yeah, that too. Yeah.
I think it'd be really, really cool for you guys. But just so you guys know too, like, super appreciative of what you guys do growing college hockey. I think it's cool that you guys do these podcasts and do posts. And sometimes in college sports, like there's a lot of really good personalities out there, and it doesn't just have to be at UMass. I think you can find some schools that are maybe a little bit under the radar. And I think you guys do an awesome job of that, talking to kids and coaches and players from different teams. And I think that's one of the great things about college hockey. Like, everyone gets a little enamored with the schools that have been around for a while, but school like UMass, we feel like we're up and coming and we got some cool stories to tell. But I feel the same way about my alma mater, RIT. Like, there's some really good, cool things going on there, and rinks, atmosphere, places to get a bite to eat, place to maybe get a pop after the game. Like, there's a lot of cool things. And appreciate you guys trying to help grow the college hockey game too.
Thank you. It means a lot.
We love Atlantic hockey too.
Yeah, we do love the Atlantic.
We eat it up. We got our own our insider right here of the Atlantic, Johnny, with us to help us out. But
yes, sir.
Yeah, we've had plenty.
East Coast expert.
Plenty of Andy's coach.
Coach, other than the Frozen Four, I got one last question for you. Other than the Frozen Four, though, with RIT, what was your favorite memory from just being a college athlete and playing for RIT there as their goalie?
I mean, as cliche as it sounds, like, we won a lot of hockey games at RIT. Like, we won three regular season championships in my 4 years. So
pretty good.
it was just fun winning all the time and sweeping a weekend, and then Saturday night kind of figuring out what was going on.
Yep.
But it's something that's hard to comprehend unless you play college hockey or go to a hockey crazy school. But, like, I still have an unbelievable relationship with all of my college teammates. We have a WhatsApp group, and there's like 80 of us on it or something crazy. And whatever, UMass is playing, and I'll get texts from guys like, hey, good luck. And guys are watching the game, sending pictures. And those relationships, like, didn't expect that. But my wedding, like, basically, I think I had 30 different former players from RIT that were at my wedding.
Wow.
So we had a really good time in Roch Vegas. sneaky good under the radar. We had a good time there, and a lot to do during the season. RIT was an awesome place to play with the corner crew. Didn't know that going into it. Like, I heard it was a hockey first school.
Yeah.
But I remember my first game riding Pine, looking at it, I was like, holy crap, like, I think I kind of lucked out coming here. Like, I better get better and stop some pucks so I can experience this in the net. And had a really good coaching staff there that gave me an opportunity and let me earn it. And some really, really good teammates that taught me some things that I still use to this day as a coach. And I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for my experience at RIT.
I love that. What about, I guess, a couple final questions that I have is, you know, like you had a great time. That Frozen Four run was nuts. I think you had 27 wins as a senior there. But like, at what point did you know, like you played in the East Coast League and the AHL, like at what point did you know that you wanted to hang them up and that you wanted to become a coach? Like, was that, you know, just that you're burning to become a coach, or was there something else that led to that?
I actually never thought about being a coach until I got into pro hockey. My first year pro, like I just missed the relationships of my coaches from college. And not just from like, they would communicate with me consistently, and I liked it when I made a mistake and they would tell me I made a mistake. And when I played well, I liked it that, hey, they might give me a pat on the back. And, like Coach Wilson at RIT, like he knew where my girlfriend was, he knew who my family was. And it meant a lot that like, he was willing to build that relationship. And it meant a lot too. Yeah. Like, hey, like you need to do this better. You got to play the puck better. You got to make better decisions. You got to make that save. I know it's a breakaway, find a way to make a save. Like, that meant a lot. And then when I got to pro, it's just different. And I'm not saying that it's any better or worse, but it's just different. And going into my second year of pro, I was not on a great contract. I was basically on PTOs. I was lucky enough to go to Bruins camp. I actually got into a preseason game, which was really cool, against the Islanders in rookie camp at beautiful Nassau Coliseum, which Laz might know a thing or two about.
Oh, yeah.
I just knew my second year I was going to be a suitcase, and just got frustrated when I would get traded from here to here and the coach would be like, hey, like, we think you're a really good goalie. You played really well, but there's this guy in this contract that's coming down, so we got to trade you. And, oh, Manny Legacy's coming out of retirement, wants to play in the American League. So goalie in the American League's coming down, we're going to trade you. And I'm just like, this is just kind of brutal. And it's just different in pro too, where in college, like, all your teammates, they're all your friends, and you have a great relationship with them. You know all their parents. You know what they got going on. You know, if whatever. JoJo's got a date with so-and-so at the movies on Wednesday night. Where in pro, like, you guys have kids, and guys are at different stages of their life, so it's just different. And my second year of pro, I just felt like, hey, like, I think I have a lot to give. And as a coach, and I coached a little bit in the summertime working goalie camps, and always felt like I could kind of help kids and have a positive effect, and kind of wanted to have the same effect on kids as my college coaches at RIT had on me, like Wayne Wilson, Brian Hills, David Sulaco, Mike Germain. All those guys were great to me. Chris Lyne, and my one coach there, actually Scott McDonald, he ended up coaching the women's team, but he was the main man that recruited me. And he switched over to the women's side, but like, he still kept a relationship with me, a relationship with my parents. And I just felt like that was special and something different. And I think kids value that honesty and that relationship. And it's no different than your mom or your dad. Like, you got a relationship with your mom and your dad when they come down on you. Like, you know what, you know, like, dad said not to do that. He's probably right. But I felt like sometimes in pro, like, literally wouldn't talk to my coach for months at a time. And then he would lay into me. I'd be like, yeah, whatever, buddy. Like, you clearly don't care about me because you haven't talked to me in months. So that was just something I think is valuable. And I think that helps our team at UMass. And that's something I try to do with our players. Like, I try to have lunch with them a lot in our players lounge. And I will yell and scream at them, but I think they know it's for their betterment. And when you have a relationship with somebody, I think you can respect that they're invested in your life and in your career and in your development.
Yeah, that's what's 100%. Great about college hockey is just the relationship aspect. Like, you have 4 years with them, they're your family.
They know no one's getting shipped out the next day for a, you know, roll of tape or something either. Like, you're sat in stone there unless you got a transfer or whatever. But yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
No, totally.
Atlantic insider John Lazarus has one final thought.
I'm a Hockey East guy tonight because
Hockey East as well. My bad.
But D-Mike, I'm telling you, and I know we talked about it before, but when I come up to UMass to grab a beer with you, I can proudly throw this card down on the bar. Ooh. I saved it. We got laminated culture cards at UMass. And I'm telling you, this thing, the culture is instilled from day one.
I love it.
For the record, I have that in my wallet. I have one on my desk. And Laz tells you can see it. But for us, they're not just words. We try to live by them. And not just at the rink with our families, with our lives and how we do things. And maybe that might sound cheesy, but it works and it wins. And culture trumps everything.
Hell yeah.
ICCCU. Is it three C's? Four C's? What is it? Three?
Three.
ICCCU.
Keep that on the down low. Come on. Keep the trade secret down low.
Yeah, come on, Laz. Well, I think that when we come down to shoot a video for you guys, I'm hoping that, I mean, one, we get bag skated and that we kind of earn our trip.
I don't want to get bag skated by Carves or DeMike.
We got to earn it because Carves will beat our ass either way. And then number two, I think we earn a laminated card if we come out of it alive. So that's what I'm hoping.
Do you guys, let me ask you, do you want to be bag skated? Do you want to block shots?
Yes.
Do you want to back check? Do you want to get pucks in deep? Like what are the things that you really want?
Those are the main cornerstones. We were giving God shit because he didn't get over 20 blocks this season.
Yeah.
According to the stat sheet. But yeah, we want to do all of them, but preferably, I think I'll just throw James since he's a bigger body.
I'm doing the block shots.
Yeah, you get
the block. I'll take the new Makar on 1-on-1.
Oh shit!
I think you guys should do the mock PK. Make
no. I'll try it out. Hey, yeah,
I'm a big PK guy. Laz knows that. We'll get you on the mock PK. But if you're looking for shot blockers, I think you need to talk to Mark Delgazzo, Colin Felix.
Oh yeah.
Garrett Waite is actually a sneaky good shot blocker.
Yeah, it's a Minnesota boy.
Cal's not bad at blocking him. Trevino, well, he can squirrel around and block some shots. So, no, Gaz is more like heavy, strong.
He's so
like,
big.
You can't take the puck from me.
Yeah.
But he will block a shot and he'll smoke a guy. He'll take the body. He can lay the lumber.
Yeah, he's physical this weekend.
I wouldn't mess with him.
Your whole team was just that. Talk about that. I just got to ask one last question from me, actually. That Duluth game. What did you say to the boys, or Carr say to the boys going into OT? Because you guys came out just way hotter than Duluth.
Smelling salts?
It was smelling salts.
Could it be?
We cracked a couple Red Bull, a couple 5-hour energies, and we got after it. But no, and I think it actually started at the end of the second. We felt, and we didn't tell the players this, but we felt like Duluth was playing really well. Mm-hmm. We felt like they were outplaying us. And actually, Coach Barr and I started to snap on the bench. Like, we started to go after it. And we tried to give the guys energy. And we really missed Carson Gashevitz. Like, he was an emotional leader for our team. He gave our players a ton of juice and ton of confidence. And we felt like we had to kind of make up for that as coaches. And after the second in our coaches meeting and in the between periods in the locker room, Coach Carville's like, hey, like, let me come down on him. You guys got to take a breath, take a step back. And Carve blistered him good. He blistered him like, hey, like, you guys want to lose to this team again? Like, we have more to give. We've barely freaking practiced here the last week. Like, we got more in the tank. You need to get desperate. We need to play to our identity. And I think it started to come over in the third. And once we tied up the game, I think that gave us a lot of energy, a lot of juice. And we talked about the four members of the band that weren't there. Like, we really missed, obviously, Jerry Harding and Henry Graham and Carson Gashevitz and Phil A. Lindbergh. And we're like, hey, like, these guys are back at home. Like, literally, they would give their arm to be in this game. Like, we have to find a way to win this game for them and give our players a ton of credit. Like, it was fun to watch that overtime, but it was also scary where it felt like we had the puck in the zone a decent amount. And then, boom, Duluth has, like, a breakaway or a potential odd man rush. And then Bobby Chirino obviously made a great play there to Garrett Waite. And like Garrett Waite, like super stoic. I think you guys probably saw his interviews, but like his celebration was like so basic. He just like put his hand up, like, oh, let's go to the national championship game. Like, it was so like subdued. But no, it was awesome.
Yeah, it looked like he'd been there before almost. It was just like, holy shit.
He's an Edina kid.
Hold it up. Yeah, true.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's tough.
We don't like Edina kids on this pod, but that's a big one.
We've had a few of them on, though. Yeah.
Hey, when we recruited him, like, the first thing I said to him, I was like, hey, like, are you an Edina cake eater? Because you're not going to fit in here. And he's like, coach, I'm from Edina, but I think I can fit in. And, I mean, when he showed up, like, he actually had on, like, he had on camouflage Crocs. And I'm like, oh. I don't think this is an Edina.
Not
bad, yeah. Have on camouflage Crocs. Like, he'd probably be having on like boat shoes and a button down or something. So this kid might be a little bit more nails than what we give him credit for.
I love it.
You got to make sure you can get pucks deep. That's at the end of the day where it all starts. And then
what it's all about.
Yeah.
Yep.
Let's go. I think that's all I had.
That's all I got for you, coach. Again, congratulations on becoming the national champs. He's right. A lot of people did doubt you, but you proved them all wrong. And that's credit to the boys and credit to your coaching ability there.
Associate head coach Jared DeMichiel here. DeMike, the GOAT. You know, he was the good cop or the bad cop? The good cop to Carve's bad cop there. Helped lead him to the Natty Championship. hoping for the best for you guys. We're going to come down and shoot a video and just get bagged and eat shots for you guys.
But not eating any shots. Yeah, those
we're going to do it all. But again, Coach, thank you so much for taking the time for us today.
Awesome. Thanks for having me, guys.
Yep.
All right. So if you're listening to this pod, we just had on two UMass legends. One is current. The other one's going to be currently going to professional hockey here real soon. But Jake Gaudet and Coach Jared DeMichiel there. I want to thank them for coming on. What a pod, James.
Yeah, no, obviously an honor to have them on after winning the national championship. An honor to have a few waters with them after the game Saturday night. And it's cool to meet those two guys and the rest of the UMass team. So shout out to all the boys there and the alumni for your, you know, on your first national championship. That one's got to feel good.
Yeah, my God. I mean, we met so many of the players at UMass. I was humbled by how many knew our names.
Yeah.
Because, like, I mean, why would they? I mean, besides coming on the pod, we had Murray. We had obviously Gaz. But then we've had guys that, you know, aren't on the team. Laz.
Yeah.
Another legend there. We had Leno and Makar, but like, yeah, a lot of these guys, I was just like, holy shit, you've listened to the pod.
Mm-hmm.
You get pucks deep, obviously.
No, I think what I said on the podcast, I said to Mike, and is credit to them and the coaching staff, but just the class acts on the team from UMass, you know, those guys coming up to us after the game. I think that, that makes all the long hours for us, easily worth it just to get to meet those guys in person. And just to hold, we got to hold the national championship trophy at the upstairs. I mean, I'm giving guy a water as soon as he walks in with the trophy off the bus. I mean, it was just an electric feeling, and you could just, it was like we were on the team almost. You could feel what they were feeling a little bit and how much that meant to those guys. So again, congrats to you guys. And we're definitely pumped to go shoot a video at NewMass now.
Oh, easily. And like, I was so heartbroken Thursday night as a UMD fan. Fully believing they're going to win until that overtime started, I'd say.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, not really seeing it so much.
Light. Those were easily the two best teams, though, in the Frozen Four.
That was like, a championship
hands down,
game.
Those.
Yep.
We knew it. We knew it kind of, too. It was just like, you know, tough. Credit to St. Cloud on a great season, though. I think they shocked a lot of people in that tournament. They played very well. And, you know, it sucks losing Broads
coming
there.
Coming back
but,
on Mankato, too, after being down.
Yeah, like
They flipped the script on that game. I didn't.
That was a hell of a game. That was probably my favorite game in the tournament, though, just because it was so high scoring. It was just back and forth. Yeah, like
you get there. I mean, we were
that
like,
tip was nasty to win, too. I mean, that was it was a fun game to watch. But
Nolan Walker shouts.
Yeah, no, that's in the Duluth game, obviously, in overtime. But all in all, we're back from Pittsburgh. The boys made it home alive.
We did.
That's honestly the biggest shocker for me, other than
13 hours there and back. I would say 14 because we got stuck in some random city in Pittsburgh for a full hour just doing a roundabout.
Yeah, we were in the Farmville, man. It was just...
We were singing John Denver Country Roads, and it felt pretty good, honestly.
It did feel like, good, except
for how
I was...
bad of the weekend was, like, you know, more out.
For not getting any sleep and just drinking a lot of water all weekend, Sunday on going on the hills and
yeah.
John Denver
Sometimes
Road was not
you gotta
fun.
Do that. Sometimes you just got to let it loose. The boys were feeling it. We got Suge Knight in the studio joining us now, Wendy. How's it feel?
Feels pretty good.
Feels pretty
nice.
I'm just, that chain's getting me. But yeah, what a trip. I will say, last thing I'll say about St. Cloud, they made me the most money this weekend. So I bet on them Thursday and I bet against Saturday and they helped out.
They helped out.
Huskies, way to help out there. But yeah, Frozen Four is awesome. Met a ton of fans, did a lot of smelling salts, got a lot of pucks deep and a lot of content. We have a video coming for you guys on our YouTube channel. Make sure you're subscribed. Hit that bell if you haven't already. We're going to have a full vlog experience of the Frozen Four. That's us road trip with the boys five deep in a freaking Mazda CX-5 2013. It's a beaut. And yeah, we went to and from and it was tough vibes on the way back. But the way there, I mean, everything, it was a great time. We love Pittsburgh and we're excited for Boston.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, just Pittsburgh, I think it shocked me just the city in itself. Pretty cool.
And what,
just a good vibe. The weather was beautiful. The bar atmosphere was great. The restaurants we went to, great food. Oof. Pittsburgh gets shit on a lot for being, you know, they are Schittsburg in a way. It did smell terrible.
At times it did. But I will say we had great weather. The double like yellow bridges was like, okay, hello. And then like you got, what was the ballpark called?
PNC.
PNC is so close to you.
It's
like,
beautiful
like
too. And it wasn't bad staying at the West in five star with all the boys.
Not at all.
There's so many pucks in deep.
Yeah.
Podcast members in that building
at any
at
point
once.
You just had a player walk out or like a guy who looked like he was talking to Butchie a minute before. We didn't see Butchie. That was the one.
Or Melrose.
Kobe. Yeah, no Melrose. They had to be at another place, don't you think? That or like there's just too much steez. They had to, you know, duck us a little bit.
I saw Kobe's getting some NHL time now.
Yeah, Kobe got
what
called
a weekend.
Up.
That's an ECH bump and a half. That's
imagine what Butchie would have got had he come on.
Yeah,
I'll say. Butchie, maybe hit us up. But yeah, it was still a great weekend. We saw a lot of faces. Like I got to talk with Easton Brodzinski's dad just out of nowhere. just a great chat. So shout out to him. He's probably not listening, but it was a good time. Yeah, we had a lot of Husky fans were there.
We did get to party with a lot of Husky fans.
I mean, UMass fans, you name it. Obviously, Bulldogs, Shane Ludke, shout out to him, getting trapped every night.
Shout out to the St. Cloud fellows. We had Rachel and Sam and Allie and the rest of the girls team all made it. The whole girls St. Cloud team made it. If that doesn't tell you they're dedicated. I mean,
Minnesota fans everywhere. How about our buddy from Toledo?
Volleyball team. What's his name? Trek.
I can't remember. I mean, all I remember is Full Diesel with that mustache. He showed up electric vibes there with he was there for Fury from Mankato.
Yep.
So a lot of Mankato fans were present. I mean, they had the biggest section in that game, I would say.
Oh, yeah.
Like, they were going nuts. They were right there to win it. Great games besides the championship, which, you know, still was a good time.
Still was a good time. And, my brain cells are gone from the smelling salts this weekend, though. That's one thing I can't get back from this weekend.
A lot of things we can't get back. I will say I got my glasses back, but the shades.
Yeah, yeah.
Tough. Sorry, Miles. So we lost a pair of sunglasses. R.I.P. Dude, I have no stomach. So let's wrap this up. Again, we just want to thank you guys all for listening to this. And, we'll have Pucks in Deep Pocket. Like, there is no offseason for UCH.
There is no. We are going to take 2 weeks off, though, if you're listening to this still. But we are going to take a couple weeks off.
We'll let you listen to this one for a couple weeks because it's going to be a doozy.
Yeah.
Edit tomorrow. I'm really excited for that. But we will be back all offseason for you guys. Remember to just check out
some
our
big
page.
Guests. Some big guests. A couple sponsors coming. We got some merch coming. It's going to be a great offseason. Excited to, start next season off in 2 weeks here. But, again, to all our fans and supporters, thank you for supporting us all season long. It was a hell of a season during COVID. Too, and we needed all you guys. So let's keep growing the game together. And until next time,
let's get pucks in deep. That's a wrap.
Woo! DJ, play us out. Let's get it started in here. And the bass keeps running.
Yeah, thank you. I need a beer.
Is the best day of my life! Yeah! UMass is the best school in the country! Yeah!
Watch out! Watch out! UMass are national champions!
Body and soul, don't move too fast, people just take it slow. Don't get ahead, just jump into it. Y'all hear about it, the P's are doing. Get started, get stupid. Don't worry about it, people will walk you through it step by step like an infant new kid. Inch by inch with a new solution. Transmit hits with no delusion. The feeling's irresistible and that's how we move it.
Everybody, everybody, let's get into it. Get stupid, get